inviting me to address the 63rd session of your Diocesan Council. I consider it a great privilege to address such an august body of the leaders of the Church of the Jaffna Diocese of the Church of South India. So when Bishop invited me to speak, he gave me the freedom to choose whatever topic I wanted. I think it's a bit dangerous to do that with attorneys at law, because then we don't stop, we continue going. But I will try not to take too much of your time and to leave with you some thoughts that can help you to reflect on what is truth and what does it mean to speak the truth in love. I thought I would keep to the theme of the Diocesan Council, this session. I want to thank Bishop Daniel for his most convicting exposition of theology of love and truth. We came together, we study the Bible, we speak about various issues. We also explored what does it mean to speak the truth in love. Most often when we say speak the truth in love, we think that we should hurt the other person's feelings. And so we don't actually speak the truth. And Bishop said, not speaking the truth is not loving. It is actually an insult to the other person, however painful it may be. So Jesus came, when he said, I am the truth, he was the revealer of who God is. He is the true revealer of God. He is the authoritative revealer of God. He is the exhaustible revealer of God. Because he came from God and he is one with God. So truth is Jesus is the truth. And whenever we speak of truth, we need to keep Jesus central to that thought, that process, and that conversation. Jesus is the embodiment of God's self-revelation, and he is the life of God. And we know the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. When Jesus said, I am the light of the world, no one who follows me stumbles around in the darkness. I provide plenty of light to live in. The Pharisees objected. They said, all we have is your word. We need more than this to go on, to believe you. Jesus replied, you are right that you only have my word, but you can depend on it being true. I know what I have come, where I have come from and where I go next. You don't know where I am from or where I am headed. You decide according to what you can see and touch. I don't make judgments like that. But even if I did, my judgment would be true because I wouldn't make it out of the narrowness of my experience, but in the largeness of the one who sent me, the Father. That fulfills the conditions set down in God's law, that you can count on the testimony of two witnesses, and that is what you have. You have my word, and you have the word of the Father who sent me. So Jesus is not like the messengers of truth who went before him. The lawgivers, the prophets, the sages. Jesus himself is the truth. And this is because he is one with the Father. So we need to keep that in mind as we explore what truth means. And Jesus said to the Jews who believed in him, if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And the freedom that Jesus offers here is freedom from sin. A freedom to overcome sin and to live a life that is full, a life where we are alive, a life that is exciting, and a life that is whole. I will encourage you to go back and look at the scripture passages. These are found in John 14, John 8. And Bishop drew us attention to several scripture passages. Please go back and look at it in the light of if Jesus is the truth, is the ultimate truth, is the ultimate reality. What does it mean in these scripture passages? Now another thing we discovered is that to speak the truth in love, we need to know our true selves. We need to get in touch with our true selves. Unless we know who we are, what is our true self, we can't speak the truth in love. So, a problem common to Christian leaders is the lack of time and the space for solitude and silence. I have often enjoyed the privilege of engaging in is that we had agreed that our education system was somehow flawed. It had taken away critical thinking and it made us just memorize what is in the text. It had taken away curiosity, a thirst for knowledge. So I started reading about Ignatian spirituality. Ignatius of Loyola, a 16th century monk, was the person who established the Jesuits. And he, when he encountered God, he was an aristocrat. He was living loosely, he was having a good life. And then he became wounded in war. While he was recuperating, while he was finding healing from those wounds, he had an encounter with God, which changed his life. And as he journeyed through that period, he wrote it down as spiritual exercises. And today they have been formulated, they have been crafted into retreats that people can go and participate in and learn what it is to have inner strength. So, but they have also modernized these spiritual exercises so that all of us can get together and do it in small groups or in our personal devotions. So I thought I will look at what is it that influences the Jesuits to give of themselves to others, to society, to social justice, to education, yeah? To live for others. What is it that propels them to live for others? And I found that Ignatian spirituality is based on the understanding that God is present in our world and He's active in our world. And He's present in our lives, He's active in our lives, and He wants us as His children to be active in the world that He has created. So God loves us, God loves His world. And as much as God loves us and God loves His world, He wants us to love the world that He has created. We need to love God and we work with God to make a difference in the world we live in. I know as Christian leaders, all of you are caught up in the frenzied urge and needs of the people you serve. And often you don't have time for yourself. So I want to place before you the utmost importance of finding, carving out spaces for yourself. So, because unless we spend time in solitude and silence, we will never discover our true selves. Because when we are rushing through life, we just bluff over things, we just cover things that are burning inside or boiling within us, the issues that we have faced, maybe as children, or maybe as adults, maybe as by our through our teachers, through our parents. We go through a damaged world, and it is inevitable that we become damaged in the process. There are negative influences in our life, there are positive influences in our life. And unless we sit down and actually reflect, we will never know what actually drives us, what is in the core of our being. We can continue being pious, we can continue preaching the word of God, but unless we know our true selves, our conviction is only part. It is not full, it is not whole. So, another thing I came across in this whole exploration of the spirituality is the Desert Fathers. These were the earliest Christian monks around the 2nd century AD. They went in the Middle Eastern deserts, they contemplated, they meditated, and then they passed their wisdom onto their disciples in the form of anecdotes. So I'm going to just read some quotes from them for us to understand how important it is to spend time in personal meditation, in solitude and silence. Because what happens is often, even in our church services, when we have a time of silence, somebody is speaking into that silence. When we spend time alone in our daily devotional, we are still, our thoughts are racing, we are wondering what to do with so and so is ill, so and so needs communion, or so and so needs to be visited, somebody in our family is not well, we need to care for them. Our thoughts are still racing. If we try to, when we get even still our thoughts, we think we need to fill that silence with speaking to God, praising God, you know, saying, telling things to God. But the purpose of this kind of solitude that helps us to connect with our true self is to not do anything, not say anything, simply focus on who God is. The Desert Fathers teach us a spirituality from below. They show us that we have to begin with ourselves and our passions, the way of God. For the Desert Fathers always passes through self-knowledge. Evergreen spontaneity. For the monks, humility is the courage to face the truth, the courage to accept their own earthiness, their humanity. Spirituality from below points out that we come to God through careful self-observation and sincere self-knowledge. We don't find out what God wants from us in the lofty ideals we set for ourselves. Often these are merely the expression of our ambition. We wish to achieve high ideals, to look better in the eyes of the other and of God. Spirituality from below thinks that we can discover God's will for us, that we can find our vocation only if we have the courage to descend into our reality and deal with our passions, our drives, our needs, our wishes. The way to God leads through our weakness and powerlessness. When we are stripped of all power, we discover what God has in mind for us. What God can make of us when God fills us completely with divine grace. So, one of the things I learned through this Ignatian spirituality is to allow God's love to work in me. I know God loves me. All of us know God loves us. We have experienced God's love. But do we really trust and rest in that love? So one of the spiritual exercises is to learn to pray through certain passages in scripture and to learn to allow God to love you, to actually say, God loves me, say my name and say, God loves me. And when I started doing that, I know God has forgiven my sin, and God has forgiven my sin past, present and future. He died for me on the cross through in Christ. But for me to know, no matter what I do, God still loves me, was a great revelation. Because the moment I realized that God loves me no matter who I am, no matter what I am, God loves me in the messiness of my being, the brokenness of my being, I found freedom. Because I didn't have to try to be somebody else in the presence of God. I didn't have to try and entertain God with my prayers. I didn't have to tell God something else that I am not when I come to before God. I could be myself. And it was free to allow God to unmask my being, to actually understand what drives me, who I am, what are my passions, what are my desires, and then to bring them before God, to be naked before God. I felt safe in doing that because I knew no matter what came out of that self-examination, God still loved me. No matter what, He still loved me. I commit sin, God still loves me. So that's why I want you to keep in mind that when we speak of God's love, it is not a romanticized notion of a nice feeling, but it is a commitment to somebody else, and that's what God shows us. So then the Blessed Fathers also tell us what it means about spirituality. Now I spoke about spirituality from below, earthly spirituality. That is where we strip ourselves naked before God and say, this is who I am, and please take me and use me. And it is only when we come to that place of powerlessness, of weakness, that God can actually use us. It is only when we have a true self-knowledge of us that we can speak the truth to others. So, in contrast, spirituality from above reacts to the rage that boils up in us by representing or crushing it. Rage is not supposed to happen. As a Christian, I've got to be friendly and balanced at all times. So I have to control my rage. Spirituality from below would mean questioning my rage, questioning what God wants to tell me with it. Perhaps my rage is pointing to some deep injury. Perhaps in my rage, I encounter a wounded child in me that reacts with important fury to harm done to me by my parents or teachers. Perhaps my rage shows me that I have given others too much power over me. In that case, rage would be the energy to free myself from the power of others so as to open myself up to God. This rage isn't automatically bad. It could be showing me the way to my true self. Through rage, I come into contact with myself, through the descent into my reality. Through my rage, I come into contact with the source of my strength as God's Spirit bubbles up within me, and so my rage leads me to God, who wishes to give me life. Rage defends me against everything that would take God's life away from me. Wherever my greatest problem lies, He is also the site of greatest opportunities. That is where my treasure is. There I come into contact with my true essence. There is something that wants to come alive, to bloom. The way to God leads through the encounter with myself, through my descent into my reality. The place where we meet our powerlessness is precisely where we become open to God. So here he talks about, sometimes we feel angry, uncontrolled anger maybe. And it is for us not to suppress it and say, no, as Christians we can't feel it. But to allow it to rage, ask God to help us to see, why do we feel so angry? A very mundane, inane example is when I drive, I really become angry. I constantly scold others. And I keep thinking of myself, I think, no, I see God is love. I have experienced God's love. And I am supposed to show love at all times. Why do I get angry? And as I kept asking God for self-revelation, I realized before my anger came from a sense of control. I wanted to control. I wanted to control how everyone else drove. So I needed to learn that of myself. And I saw that reflected in other areas of my work as well. When I provide leadership, I want sometimes control and things to go my way. And I had to learn it the hard way. I had to allow God's Spirit to work in me to bring self-revelation. It is a very simple, almost silly example. To give and not to count the cost. To fight and not to heed the wounds. To toil and not to seek for rest. To labor and not to ask for reward. Save that of knowing that I do your will. Amen.